I think that we can make a start. I would like to thank John Devine, who is one of our sarcoidosis patients at Royal Brompton Hospital, who will be chairing the session, the first session about pharmacological treatment options in sarcoidosis. John, thank you very much for accepting to be part of this webinar. And I would also like to extend my greetings to Dr. Elizabeth Renzoni, who is one of our senior consultants, although very young, but one of the most senior consultants after Athol, long-standing part of the sarcoidosis service, who will present us a few things about the pharmacological treatment options. Dr. Felix Chua, another senior consultant, will try to join, but it's not definite whether he will manage to do so, but if he will try to join for our discussion session. John, I'll leave things over to you. Thank you again for coming.
Thank you, Vasily. We'll just play John's introduction video.
Yeah, my name is John Devine. I'm a patient at the Brompton at the moment, have been for the last 6 or 7 years, although I actually got sarcoidosis, great, you know, 19 years ago. Went from running around mountains, cycling hundreds of miles and that kind of thing to suddenly, I mean, it was literally almost overnight. Well, it wasn't, it was over a few months, not being able to run, although still being able to cycle and do a lot of things. Actually, I've just bought an electric bike to get back into that. I'm pretty sure I got it from a new building that we'd just moved into. I'm working at a sixth form college at the time, and it was literally being built on photocopiers opening onto classrooms, and they forgot to turn the, the air conditioning on for the first 4 months. So I walked into that building fit as a fiddle, and within 4 months, you know, got it, this whole thing. Interestingly, I do think it's to do with the chemical involvement from the photocopies, because everything else was exactly the same before. Anyway, unfortunately, it's moved to sort of advanced pulmonary fibrosis pretty quickly. Although after 3 years and then 6 years, on two occasions, I was told it had stabilized. I'm never convinced because I never felt quite right. And then after about 7 years, it was clear that the lungs were deteriorating still. Anyway, to cut a long story short, I didn't have any drugs for 12 years of it. And then fortunately, well, not fortunately, I got a bad chest infection. But it was fortunate, actually. And I got referred to the Brompton because I was working in London and living in London. And before that, I'd been at various other places, which were fine, but this kind of made a big difference. And I got put on drugs straight away, first time after 12 years. I never know if they put me on steroids or methotrexate originally. Who knows what might have happened? I don't know whether it was already fibrosis or inflamed or whatever. Anyway, so then I went on the methotrexate and the steroids. As far as we know, everything's been stable since then for 6 years, 6.5 years. And, you know, I kind of have just been getting on with life with serious physical limitations, obviously, you know, you know, that has its issues, but, you know, more or less functioning, bringing up my son, doing my job, etc. But I did get, there are issues with medications. I mean, I've had many more infections since then, bone density issues, you know, not much brain fog from the methotrexate, but, you know, occasionally I get some of that. You know, can't drink obviously easily, which I used to enjoy, if you know, so you've got to be more aware of it. But anyway, it's, you know, manageable. And then things shifted 3 years ago, and unfortunately I got a bad chest infection, really bad. I think it was a virus just in the months leading up to the outbreak of COVID. And that was really bad. It knocked me out for several months. I do wonder if it actually was COVID, because we were in Italy, in the Lombardy region in October, which was actually where COVID hit. But anyway, I had that infection. It was beginning to clear in the following, believe it or not, March the 12th. I was in Scotland getting one of the very first COVID tests. And they said it wasn't COVID, but, you know, and this was beginning to clear. But I would say the last 3 years have been the most difficult. And I don't think it's to do with my health, because my health has been stable. But I do think it is in the COVID context. I'm sorry to mention that a lot, but I do think it is. Because on immunosuppressant drugs, being suddenly told that you are clinically vulnerable in a way, you know, you're extremely vulnerable. And to sort of sum that up, I kind of feel before COVID, you know, my identity was primarily as a John who is a teacher, a partner, a parent, a friend, a football manager of our local kids team and things like that. And I also had sarcoidosis, and that could be a bit of an issue, and it could have flare-ups, but it was being well managed at the Brompton. I really want to say how chuffed I am and how thankful I am to the Brompton and the team there, because they've been brilliant. And, you know, the medication issues they're very aware of. They know those. Since COVID, and initially in the first year when we were all dealing with it, you know, it was, I hate to say it, but it was almost like we're all in it together. It was almost for a while, people kind of, yeah, you know, the kind of war spirit or whatever it was. But after 3 years of, you know, suddenly it's like, oh, right, well, we've got to be careful when we're around John, because quite rightly, because he's immunosuppressed. So my identity shifted. And my wife says this now, and it's become tricky, which is, you know, I'm now John who has sarcoidosis, who also happens to be a parent, a partner, etc. But oh yeah, well, we're going to see John. Yeah, well, we can, but we can't really, because he needs to sit outside when we have a drink. So it's shifted, and I know that, you know, COVID moved on, and thankfully it has for everybody, most people. You know, my son, my wife, you know, she's just been to Japan for 4 weeks, doesn't worry about it for a minute. I do think it's an issue about what risks and how we deal with it, those of us who are sort of at risk from it. And I'm sorry to focus on that, but I'm talking about my experience, and my experience has been that I've managed to live with sarcoid pretty well, to be honest with you, with some of the effects of the drugs. But since COVID, it's difficult, and I know we have to make decisions. They're very hard to do, given that one's not clear about outcomes and things. So I suppose that's where I'm at right now, is wondering where, and occasionally I think, can't I come off these drugs? Because I wonder if without the drugs, I wouldn't be as vulnerable. I know. So anyway, that's where I, but you know, I've lived with sarcoidosis for 20 years, and I've lived a good life on the whole with some serious limitations. I don't want to undermine it. It affects your relationships, it affects your friends. You know, we know it's not easy to live with, but it's been okay. And as I say, the worst thing that could kind of hit you with somebody with those vulnerabilities 3 years ago is an airborne, pretty vicious viral illness. I just want to finish by saying, you know, I'm really pleased to be on this day. I was at the last one, and you know, I just want to say these opportunities are fantastic. Thank you for all the people running the thing, putting it on at Sarcoidosis UK, and for, you know, again, I suppose I think I did say it during this thing, but you know, thank you to the consultants, the team at the Brompton, for being part of all this as well, because it makes a bit, you know, it genuinely is something that is really, really useful.
Thank you, John. Let's offer now the podium to Elizabeth, and then John could start some of the questions. Elizabeth, over to you.
Thank you, Vasilis, and thank you, John, for that great introduction and for his very kind words. I'm just going to share my screen now, if I can find. I can't find anymore my. So share. No. Sorry, I'm very sorry. I had the.
Elizabeth, if you can open your presentation.
I know. I can't. I can't see it in the. For some reason, show all windows. Here it is. Okay, I'm very sorry. Sorry about that. Can you all see the presentation?
Yeah, please put it in presentation mode.
Yeah, I will. Here we go. And you can hear me okay?
Great. Yeah.
Okay, fine. So I'm just going to be very briefly speaking about a few issues on the treatment, and then we can move on to the discussion. So I've been asked to speak about pharmacological treatment, and then later this morning there will be a session on non-drug treatment of sarcoidosis. And so just to begin with, when do we think about starting treatment in sarcoid? And for this, we follow Professor Wells's main dichotomy in considering treatment. And so there are two main indications. One is for major loss of quality of life, and the other is if there's danger to reduce function of one or more organs. usually the lungs, but we'll hear also about the heart and others. Actually, the overwhelming majority of patients with sarcoidosis have normal life expectancy, and only less than 10% of patients have a reduced life expectancy from sarcoid. And respiratory failure, so lung failure, or heart involvement from sarcoidosis are the two main causes of reduced life expectancy. So to begin with, I'll speak about the treatment options for symptoms that are causing a major loss of quality of life. In sarcoidosis, often this is very severe fatigue or joint pains, skin disease, etc. And for this, first of all, the discussion with the patient is absolutely key. And we need to come to a joint decision as to whether we treat or don't treat. And the decision not to treat is one where you can use just symptomatic treatment for joint pains. And we'll hear more about non-pharmacological management of fatigue. If, however, one arrives at a joint decision to treat, after having heard about all the pros and cons, options would include low-dose steroids, hydroxychloroquine, which is a very mild immunomodulant drug that doesn't require blood test monitoring. And only in particular cases would we be considering methotrexate or azathioprine. And of course, there are non-pharmacological options. When we're considering treatment, and as we've said, progression of lung fibrosis is one of the things we worry most about. And so we need to identify patients that are at risk of progression of the lung fibrosis. And this is basically based on two things. One is the severity of the lung fibrosis, and to gauge that, one would look at symptoms of breathlessness, but also lung function and imaging. And also, how is the disease behaving over time? And that's why we do the lung function tests at regular intervals. If we're considering toxicity of treatment, we know that the worst side effects come from high dose steroids for long periods of time. So being on a high dose for months and months and months, or even years, very bad side effects, followed by what we call second line agents or immunosuppressants, and the most common are methotrexate and azathioprine, followed by a low dose of steroids. So the low dose of steroids we consider around 7.5 is probably associated with the lowest side effects between these three options. The BCS clinical statement on pulmonary sarcoidosis, which was recently published, states that while there is no evidence for any particular regimen in sarcoidosis, the majority of patients with sarcoid needing treatment should initially be started with steroids. But the dose can range from between 10 milligrams a day if the disease is so long-standing and only very slowly progressing, up to higher doses, 20 to 40 milligrams a day in more acute disease. That then gets tapered, aiming for a maintenance of between 5 and 10 after these initial higher doses for at least 6 to 12 months. The main reasons for using these second line agents are either the steroids on their own are not sufficient to control the disease. You need steroid sparing agents for patients who need steroids in the long term to allow a reduction in the steroids to what we consider a reasonably safe dose of 7.5, 5 milligrams a day. Or in some patients, even very low doses of steroids just cause intolerable steroid side effects, and you would use immunosuppressants sometimes in rare cases from the beginning on their own. And just briefly, methotrexate is the most commonly used second line agent for sarcoidosis. We start off with a lower dose, increase the dose over the following months. This does need blood tests checked regularly, initially more frequently, then every 3 months. And the toxicity is mainly liver. So that's why we need to do the blood tests on a regular basis, lower blood count. We've heard about the increased infection frequency, and you can't use it if you're planning for a pregnancy because of the risk to the fetus. The alternative is azathioprine. Again, you start with a lower dose, increase it over a month or two. Again, needs blood test monitoring. Toxicity, quite similar, liver, but it doesn't cause problems to the unborn fetus, so it can be used if needed during pregnancy. It also is associated, can be associated with low white blood counts, and it also can be associated with increased frequency of infection. And so we add broadly a second line agent from the start if we're quite concerned that the disease is going to progress and that we're not going to manage with just a low dose of steroids on its own. After a period of treatment, when we've looked at the response to high dose steroids and then we add them in, or else, as I've said before, when we find that a low dose of prednisone doesn't hold the disease or is associated with significant side effects. And then finally, there is infliximab, which is a biologic agent. It's an anti-TNF, which is a pro-inflammatory cytokine, and it's considered a third line agent and to be considered in sarcoidosis only after second line treatments such as azathioprine or methotrexate have not been effective, only in the case of severe or progressive disease despite the conventional treatments. In the UK, infliximab is not routinely available for sarcoidosis. However, thanks to the very hard work of Vasilis and Vicky Sinkuri and lots of other people, there has been a very recent agreement with NHS England for treating neurosarcoidosis refractory to conventional treatment with infliximab. There are currently discussions taking place with NHS England on treatment with infliximab for other non-lung refractory sarcoidosis, whereas the treatment with infliximab is not available for refractory, so unresponsive pulmonary sarcoidosis because there is limited evidence of benefit in pulmonary sarcoidosis. And so with that, I've finished my very short presentation. I look forward to our discussion.
Hi. Yeah, great. Thanks. Interestingly, because I was sent quite a lot of questions beforehand, I have to say that a lot of them have been covered in that by looking at the alternatives and the different various treatments. But a few more, I'm just going to use ones that have come in. I'm trying to get some out of the chat as well, but they tend to have been a bit more general.
John, for some reason, I can't see you. I don't know if the others can see you.
Ah, because I didn't turn my video on, I think. Sorry. There we are. Thank you.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, that's probably the reason. Okay. So the questions we've got are around the things that you were talking about. I think pretty much all of it. One sort of question that sort of obviously touches on the effects is somebody's asking, are the medications really just keeping the problems at bay? They're saying, I've been allergic to andronic acid. The steroids have destroyed my bones, teeth, and hair. I'm now worrying about osteoarthritis, etc. And they mention, I think you've mentioned them all. They said, I've been on methotrexate and
hydroxychloroquine. Yes.
That's the one, yeah. Is there anything else you can suggest? I kind of think you've suggested it. So the issue really then is about the long-term stuff. And to me, it's a trade-off. But, you know.
Absolutely. And of course, unfortunately, we don't have a treatment that will get rid of sarcoidosis. That is, of course, the aim for the future would be to have something that just you take a period of treatment and you don't need it anymore. And instead, in the sort of chronic progressive sarcoidosis, in the sense of it would progress if you don't have treatment, then you do need chronic treatment. And as you say, when you're making decisions about treatment, it's always about a balance and you're trying to decide, is that disease going to progress and cause further harm to one or more internal organs like the lungs or the heart or another organ, in which case you do need to continue treatment, or is the disease now settled and we can start to slowly reduce treatment and continue to monitor and see whether things are stable. And at each sarcoid visit, that's what we're thinking through with patients, is the disease, is it okay to reduce treatment, or do we risk the disease progressing? And sometimes you reduce treatment and the disease progresses, and you just have to try to reduce treatment and closely monitor to find that out. But unfortunately, in some cases, you do need long-term treatment and you go for the least toxic of the options you have, which are not many. We don't have that many options.
Okay, yeah, fine. Yeah, I think that covers it again. A few sort of quick little ones that I want to get in of specific things. I don't know if this is fair, but for example, somebody has asked, can you have HRT medication while you are on, is it safe for sarcoidosis patients to go on HRT medication?
I would say overall, yes, there have been a few reports suggesting there might be a slightly increased risk of thromboembolic disease and sarcoid. So I think if you are someone that has a predisposition to clots or have had clots before, have had deep venous thrombosis, then I would avoid it. But if you don't have risk factors for thromboembolic disease and you've discussed it with your GP, I think it would be safe to do it.
Okay, and another one, somebody's saying they've been on 7.5 milligrams of prednisolone for 17 years, I think it is.
Okay.
I think you kind of covered this in your talk, though. 7.5 is a sort of, or not maintenance, but a moderate level. The rest of that question is 17 years on 7.5 milligrams and would like to try an alternative immunosuppressant because of the effects. But I kind of think, you know, do they switch to something?
I guess this is more of a sort of case-by-case discussion.
Well, exactly.
And it's difficult to say anything. I mean, we're always trying to reduce, even from 7.5. If someone has been on 7.5 for a long time and the disease is stable, one might want to try to gradually come down. Once you reach the 5 milligrams once daily dose and you've been on that for many years, we would need to check the adrenal reserve. And that would need to be checked before you reduce further. But without knowing more details about the individual case, I can't say whether it's safe to do that, whether, you know, someone needs something else. It is patient by patient, the decision about is it safe or not. Sometimes we, as I said, we try, if the disease, if everything seems stable, we will try to reduce the pred dose to the minimum dose that maintains the stability. And sometimes you can just continue reducing and the disease is now sort of burnt out and you can maintain stability. Other times, as you reach a certain dose, 5, 4, you know, even a tiny dose, you see that things worsen and you have to go back to the previous dose. So it's very individualized.
Great, thanks. I'm sorry, another specific treatment question, which is mycophenolate.
Okay.
500 milligrams daily. And the question is simply, is this a common treatment?
Yeah. I mean, it's less common than methotrexate and azathioprine, but has also been looked at in sarcoidosis. I know that our dermatologist finds that, Dr. Singh finds that mycophenolate works quite well, particularly for the skin. And there have been series looking at mycophenolate also for the lungs. And it seems also to have beneficial effects. So although it's less frequently used in sarcoidosis, we do have patients on mycophenolate.
Okay, fine. And just another one, which I kind of think you've covered, but I want to ask the particular questions that they've asked, which is, in your experience, does azathioprine work as well as I can't remember the other one that it's instead of steroids or
methotrexate. Methotrexate or azathioprine.
Yeah.
There has been a study, a retrospective study, so it's not a clinical trial. So of course, to answer these questions definitively, you would need a a randomized controlled clinical trial and patients having and being followed up prospectively. But there has been a retrospective study from the Dutch group looking at comparing methotrexate and azathioprine, and the effects seem to be similar on pulmonary sarcoidosis.
Okay, fine. And then just
go. For example, it through, in a woman of childbearing age who wants to become pregnant, you would use azathioprine rather than methotrexate. So in younger patients, right, you might choose to use azathioprine if you're considering having a family.
Brilliant. I mean, I'm sticking to the pharmaceutical questions, really.
Of course, because that's the topic.
That's the session. Yeah,
that's the
load
topic.
Of other things. Yeah, there's a lot of other stuff flying around as well. But,
of course.
Have somebody else due to start adalimumab? Not mentioned as a third. Is that, I mean,
that's very similar to infliximab, so an anti-TNF agent. So in that same category.
Okay, fine. And then I think I just kind of get the spirit of one of the questions that I kind of half asked early on, where they were saying, are the meds just prolonging the problem? It's kind of an interesting way to put it, is it just deteriorating anyway, but the meds are just kind of delaying the inevitable in some people? Or, I mean, I think you've answered it, is it, that's not the case, is it? That's
no,
not.
And I mean, there aren't trials looking at this long term, but we certainly have experience of patients that have stopped medication, the disease has progressed, then you restart medication, and sometimes you can't get back to where you were before, but you certainly stop the progression, halt that progression. So I don't think the medications we're giving are prolonging the problem. I think they are controlling the sarcoidosis, although which would otherwise progress. And the problem with sarcoidosis progressing is in the lungs and in the heart, that it then progresses to scar tissue. And once you have established scar tissue, you can't go back. So you've lost lung function, heart function. And that's why, you know, early recognition of patients who are going to progress towards scarring is important. So the medications are controlling rather than causing the chronicity of the sarcoidosis, but I completely agree they do have a lot of side effects. I mean, not always, but you know, as you were saying in your story, there are side effects. In your case, lots of chest infection. So there are trade-offs.
Yeah, I mean, with my case, just to come back exactly what you're saying, mine was one where clearly it was progressing and it's quite, you know, it needed dealing with. And so the idea I got was that, and that's what I think I said in my thing, is when I initially went there, there was kind of uncertainty about whether to treat. Because the treatment can actually stop progression, as in...
That's the reason to treat is that, and sometimes it can improve the situation. So that is the reason for treating.
Yeah, okay. And there's just a few more on specific drugs. There's the old question of, can I take vitamin D when I'm, you know, I know this isn't a pharmaceutical treatment really, but it's that comes up a lot about, can I take vitamin D?
Yeah, it comes out a lot in clinic as well. And, you know, there is a degree of uncertainty about that. But the reason why we're careful about vitamin D is that it can cause high levels of calcium either in the blood or in the urine. And there is some suggestion that it might even cause a flare in the sarcoidosis activity. However, if a patient has reduced bone density, like bad osteopenia or osteoporosis, and has a low vitamin D, then we do cautiously introduce vitamin D at a low level and then monitor regularly serum calcium, 24-hour urinary calcium, just to make sure it's not causing trouble. So it's not that it's never permitted, but it always has to be in discussion with your sarcoid specialist.
Okay, yeah, right. Is that somebody wanting to come in? I just was going to ask, is there's a question, I don't know what this is, but can I please ask if prednisolone increases the amount of sebum, S-E-B-U-M, I don't know what that is.
Sebum, little sort of oily, either oily skin or possibly, I don't know if it's, I have been on prednisolone, my sebum, it looks as if I'm sweating. So I see it. So it's probably just slightly oily skin, possibly. And I guess it could be associated with that. I'm not sure, but it could be, I imagine.
Okay.
I mean, sometimes certainly it can cause you to have more frequent, like little, you know, skin, how do you call it, the little furuncles that you get, you know, on the skin, that can certainly, and it can cause trouble to the skin, like skin thinning, more frequent sort of capillary breakages. So prednisolone does affect the skin, so I wouldn't be surprised if it doesn't cause a bit more of change in the
okay.
Sebum.
Okay. The other thing I was just going to say, I mean, it's interesting that because all those things, I mean, mine was, you know, fairly severe with pulmonary scarring and a little bit in the heart. Because I think everything you're saying is always back to that. Well, you know, it's not nothing sarcoidosis, but it's about what are the effects of these things compared with, you know, the sarcoidosis.
Exactly.
Yeah. And one has to live with some of these things. And I mean, even in my case, as I said, for 20 years, you know, with the last 6 years, pretty powerful drugs at times, you know, yeah, they have an effect, and there's no doubt. I mean, you know, somebody said, would you rather have sarcoidosis or not? I know what my answer would be.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. It's one of the least of two evils, isn't it? Exactly. I mean, we know they're both evils. Mm. It's just...
What I always gather from Vasilis and, you know, people, is that this is the constant weighing up from, you know, about drugs and this. And of course, we're all thinking, oh, can't we just have a perfect drug that doesn't do anything to us other than, you know, other than make it all right or make it all better. But, you know, not quite the case there at the moment. Because funny enough, this is different from usual. Usually, we cram two questions in at the end, but now we've got room for loads. So I'm just trying to find if there's any more coming up that I've not covered. I'm sure there are, but it's quite hard to keep a track of all of them on the site here. What else have we got? I mean, I suppose you've kind of, I mean, there's one which is a more of a general one. At what point do we consider treatment where there is a diagnosis of small airway disease or pulmonary fibrosis? I think you kind of covered that in your answer.
At what time do we consider treatment?
Yeah, when there's a diagnosis of pulmonary fibrosis or small airway disease.
No, absolutely. So basically, it depends on... how severe the lung disease, because we're talking about lungs, right, with fibrosis and airways. And first of all, it's true that sarcoidosis can either give you or both give you scarring of the lungs, but also trouble with the airways. And sometimes the airways predominate, sometimes the scarring in the periphery of the lungs predominate.
Mm-hmm.
And when you're making a decision about treatment, let's say it's the first time, it's a new patient with sarcoidosis, you are putting together how the patient feels, how breathless they are, how long they can walk on the flat, or climbing upstairs, etc. How bad the disease looks on the CT. And also on looking at the CT, does it look mainly scarring, or is there evidence of some active sarcoidosis? It's never easy to see it definitively on the CT, whether it's active or it's burnt out, but you can get a bit of an impression on that. And then how severe is the lung function impairment? And the more extensive the disease on CT, the more severe the lung function impairment, the more severe the symptoms, the more we will be moving towards treatment. Instead, if you have almost normal lung function, the symptoms are not that bad, and there is, yes, some sarcoidosis on the CT, but things seem to be quite mild in terms of the functional impairment, we would normally decide to monitor and just wait and see what happens. And that is the case for many patients with sarcoidosis. For many patients with sarcoid, you would consider treatment mainly for quality of life, and the patients may decide, actually, I'd rather be tired than take the steroids, or I'd rather try hydroxychloroquine. It's only when we feel there's risk to the lungs or to the heart or to the nervous system, you know, when there's risk to that. And that basically depends on severity. If you can't decide based on how severe the disease is, you would monitor and see, does it change over time? And the fact that it's changing over time, worsening over time, tells you the disease is active. And sometimes you might have severe disease, but it's burnt out, and it's not going to progress. So it's always a balance between severity, not a balance, it's putting together that a severity and likelihood of worsening off treatment.
That's the one we're looking for, the severe one that burns out. If you've got,
yes.
Somebody says neurosarcoidosis and neuron multisemic. By the way, people, if I'm missing a few, it's inevitable. There's about 30 or 40 questions coming in. A lot of them aren't specifically on pharmaceutical stuff, which I've been told to focus on pharmaceutical. The general ones will be answered during the day, hopefully. But this one is about a drug, which I have neuro and multisystemic sarcoidosis. I've been treated with Remicade after steroids didn't work.
I think for the neurosarcoidosis, there's going to be another session. So I would leave that. I'm seeing here something about secondary adrenal insufficiency.
Yes.
So life is a balancing act as to whether symptoms are sarcoid-based or low cortisol. And that is true. That is a very good point. As I said, when you get to 5 milligrams, usually it's 5 milligrams, that corresponds pretty much to the level of your natural steroids. And so if you come down from 5 and come down further, you've been on steroids for a long time, your adrenal glands are no longer used to making steroids, and your body will feel the effect of missing steroids. And the effects of low adrenal reserve and low cortisol levels in the blood are very similar in some ways to the fatigue and the joint pains that you can get with sarcoid. So it's true that it is sometimes difficult to establish which one it is. Usually the fatigue that you get from steroid withdrawal happens straight away as you're coming down with the steroids. Whereas if it's the fatigue related to sarcoid activity, it usually is okay for a few months and then starts increasing. But again, that is something to consider because it can be confusing to try and differentiate the two.
Okay, fine. I've just realized there's a question session and there's a chat session as well, Dr. Renzoni. So there's one going, I said, I've asked the question about calcium. And
okay.
Sarcoid.
What do they ask?
I've asked about calcium and sarcoid as have cardiac sarcoid and osteopenia. What's the relationship between calcium and sarcoid?
It's just that sarcoidosis is associated with the risk of high calcium in the blood or in the urine. And so it goes back to my original points. If one has osteopenia, so low bone density, one would look at vitamin, we wouldn't give calcium supplements, but we might consider low vitamin D doses if the vitamin D level in the blood is very low. But, you know, we would look at the individual patient, look at the vitamin D levels and decide based on that.
Okay.
But we tend not to give supplements with calcium just because of the risk of hypercalcemia, so high calcium in the blood or high calcium in the urine. But we do consider giving a low dose of vitamin D in particular cases if the vitamin D of the patient is low.
Okay, fine. I mean, there's one which may come on the next session, I don't know, but I don't know whether it counts as a natural treatment or drug, is what's the professional opinion on replacing prednisolone with medical marijuana to reduce inflammation? I don't know if that's a non-drug topic.
I don't have experience with that, so I can't say. It might be that the next session is able to to look into that.
Yeah, because yeah, that's been using first things. Okay, I think, I mean, I kind of, we're right at the end of it. I'm just wondering if there's anything, and I've kind of discovered there's a question section and there's also the webinar chat thing, so just quickly whipping through that.
I can see here there's another one about how do you know when treatment can be reduced?
Oh yeah.
And I think again, it's if one, let's say the problem is lung sarcoid, pulmonary sarcoidosis, symptoms will be looked at, and lung function, and if needed, the CT. And if everything is stable for some time, let's say on 10 milligrams of prednisone, we would always try and reduce it. We reduce it a bit and repeat the lung function and look at the symptoms. Are they the same? We can reduce further. Are they getting worse? We have to go back to the previous dose. So it's always trying, a trial and error, basically. You try to reduce, you're always trying to reduce, or often trying to reduce, and then you look at what happens. Because we don't have good markers. There's no blood test that you can do and say, oh, sarcoid is still active and it's causing trouble to the lungs. We need to increase, or everything is quiet, we can reduce. We don't have a single biomarker. We have a number of things that we look at and try and guess, basically.
Yeah. I think that's probably, I don't know if Vasilis is coming back in, I think that's the end of our session. I mean, just from my point of view, Dr. Renzoni, thank you very much. It was,
thank you. Thank you.
Answering all the questions, it was great.
And thank you for sharing all of it. You've done a great job.
Well, thank you. And I mean, for everybody who didn't quite get what they, there's endless questions, and it's going to go on during the day with all the other sessions as well. So hopefully things will come in. But I think we've come to the end of this session. I presume that somebody.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. Thank you, Elizabeth.
Thank you, Vasilis. Thank you, John.
Thank you.
It is hard work. I think as a message, it's very difficult to answer individual questions about everyone's experience, but if anyone would like to ask questions in a more broad scheme of things to try this to be answered as best as possible. We will move on to a break and restart in a few minutes.